Hi guys, I'm Mateen. I'm a second year economist at Cambridge, and I'm going to give you an idea of the kind of question you might get at an economics interview at Oxbridge. Okay, so it begins as follows, with the following question. I give you £100. You must offer part of it to someone. If they reject the offer, you get nothing. How much do you offer? So it's quite a straightforward question to begin with. If any of you have done elementary game theory, then you'll recognize this as the Ultimatum Game, a dynamic game which is set up as explained. And basically, your aim is to maximize how much you get. And obviously, there's a trade-off between how much do you offer, and then there's a risk of them rejecting you. So the main standard approach is to begin with the basis of rational choice theory. And this assumes that each agent, you and the other player, are perfectly rational, and they're simply trying to maximize their monetary payoff. So how much money is there altogether? So we have £100. And we're going to assume that the smallest division of money is a single pence, one pence. You could assume £1, maybe that they might tell you in the interview what to assume. So you're going to assume one pence. So the game can be modeled as follows. Now, if you've heard of the game, you might already know the conclusion. If you haven't, then like much of economics, you can work it out with a bit of common sense. So I'm going to model the game in what might appear a little excessively complicated to begin with, but you'll see why I do it in a moment. So because it's a dynamic game, I'm going to draw a tree. And it's going to be as follows. I'm going to draw a cone to represent. This is player one's decision node. I'm going to draw a cone to represent all the possible offers that player one could give. Okay, and denote any given offer as X. X being what player two received. Okay, so here we have player two's payoff as X, and then 100 minus X as your payoff. So clearly this is what you're trying to maximize. And it makes intuitive sense that what you receive is 100, which is the total amount, subtracting minus the amount you offer. Okay, so this is your decision. This is how much do you offer. Okay, and then player two has to make the decision whether to accept or reject the offer that you give them. So either if they choose to accept, in which case your payoff is 100 minus X, and they of course receive X. Alternatively, if they reject, then you both receive nothing. You both get zero payoff. Okay, now if we're going to assume perfect rationality, then clearly it seems that the answer to this, if we're going to work backwards, so this is often how you solve dynamic games, you work backwards, then clearly player two, being rational, will always accept your offer so long as X is non-zero. So as long as X is greater than zero. And knowing this, it seems very obvious what offer you should give. If X is always greater than zero, you want to maximize 100 minus X. You should offer one pence. So X equals, if we're going to work in pounds, we're going to say 100 is pounds, then X should equal 0.01, giving the player two a payoff of X and giving you a payoff of £99.99. So this conclusion that X equals 0.01, that the offer you should give is one pence, is what's known as the subgame perfect Nash equilibrium, or alternatively in this case the backwards induction equilibrium, because as you just saw, we solved this game working backwards. So we found out, what's player two's strategy? What's his best response to whatever you do? And we worked out that that's actually accepting the offer, so long as X is greater than zero. And then given that, what do you do? Well, you decide to offer 0.01. So you could just stop there, but when you think about it, actually, if you were given £100 and you had to share it with another real life person, Would you follow the advice of this model and actually offer one pence? Well, chances are you won't, and you probably shouldn't either. Because actually, a lot of what the experimental evidence surrounding this game done on the Ultimatum Game suggests is that this is not the case. It doesn't happen. This isn't a legitimate equilibrium. And actually, around offers of 30% or less are normally rejected. Okay, so in that case, what is the reason? Are we even playing the ultimatum game? What should you actually offer, going back to the question? So this really goes back to our assumption of rationality. We're assuming that the other player only cares about their monetary payoff, and that as such, they will accept any offer, which is strictly positive. But in reality, people often exhibit other preferences, what are known as social preferences. So, for example, they may care about the division, the share, this difference between 100 minus x and x. They actually care about the difference, and they might be what's called inequity averse. They're equity conscious. They care about how much they get relative to you. And that if they perceive the share to be unfair, they will reject it. Alternatively, you don't know whether they have that preference or not, but because you fear they could, you decide to give an offer which is higher, precisely because of the fact that they may have that preference. Alternatively, they might have a preference known as reciprocity, which means that they assume that there's some social norm, some basic level of fairness that you will engage in, that you will give a certain close to 50-50 offer, and that if you don't, you'll be punished for it. Even though it'll mean that they end up with a lower monetary payoff, they may feel more satisfied punishing you than any small amount of monetary payoff. There are various extensions to the ultimatum game and various variations, which they may or may not explore in the interview. For example, there's one simpler game which is called the Dictator Game, and actually there is no second stage. You simply give an offer, they don't have the choice to reject, and they have to accept whatever you give. And actually, evidence surrounding, and that's known as the Dictator Game. So evidence surrounding that game lends some more support to the idea that actually people are acting rationally, because it's found that offers are generally much lower in the Dictator Game. They don't fear reciprocity from player two. They don't fear being punished. So generally, offers are lower. However, there is also evidence against that conclusion. People still being equity conscious in their decision to in their offers that they give. And another variation is called the Pirate Game, where it's basically the Ultimatum Game, but with five players instead of just two. And the conclusions to these are often very interesting and contrast a lot with what you would intuitively believe to be the result. Okay, so I hope that gave you an idea of what to expect at an economics interview. I think hopefully I showed that often the questions can start off sort of simple. Perhaps you've even heard of it, that's a bonus. But if you haven't, there's no need to worry. You just have to read the question very carefully, really ascertain what it is they actually want from you, and then to explore that. Often in an interview, if they have this kind of question, they'll develop it. So, for example, in the question we just had, there are various ways that they may have progressed. They could have looked at other games, developed the actual game, perhaps looked at some of the experimental evidence. Usually they don't do all of this, but some of the things. But the main thing I think to take away is that really, once after you have read the question very carefully and you know what it is they want from you, is to not necessarily take the question for face value. So, for example, this question, it asks, how much do you offer? But it doesn't say how much do you offer given that you want to maximize your monetary payoff. It's actually quite an open question. So for all you care, perhaps you are equity conscious and you would do 50-50 because you would feel bad, you know. So and you could tell the interviewer this and explain your reasoning why, and that's not something they disregard. In fact, that would help give insight into the actual question, as we saw. It helps explore social preferences and this idea. So definitely kind of questioning the underlying assumptions of the question is something I'd recommend after you've kind of had a bit of time to think about the question itself. So if you'd like any more information about applying to Oxbridge or your application for economics or any other subject, definitely check out gurume.co.uk. The link will be in the description below.